The following video is fairly long. There are links in the description below so that you can watch pieces of it at a time instead of committing to the whole thing. I did it this way instead of forcing people to watch multiple videos on the same game. So let's get all the usual details out of the way first. Dragon's Dogma is an open-world action RPG that was developed by Capcom. It was released for PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360 back in 2012. A PC port was just released in January in 2016 for those watching in the future. The reason that you'll see Dark Arisen added to the title of the game in so many places is that the game's major expansion was bundled with the PC release. The whole situation is very much like the PC port of Dark Souls that included the Artorias of the Abyss content. I have a lot to say on this game, and I'm going to be upfront about my thoughts being quite chaotic. I played the game twice, once on normal mode for about 47 hours, and then a second time on hard mode for about 70 hours. I have never played a game before that made me change my mind on its quality as much as this one did. At the beginning, I hated it. A few hours later, I was loving it, then hating it again. I settled into something close to apathy at the beginning of my hard mode run, and then switched once again between loving it and hating it. Above all else, Dragon's Dogma is a very strange game. For those unfamiliar with the game, here's how it all works. Dragon's Dogma opens with a tutorial that has you playing a separate character, not the one you create, going through some monsters and a boss battle. You're introduced to the game's main villain, Grigori the Big Bad Dragon. This section ends at a deliberately confusing cold cutaway to your actual character and their introduction. You live on a coastal town, the dragon attacks. You try to fight it and he steals your literal physical heart as punishment for your defiance. This inflicts you with some sort of curse. People know this as the Arisen. You've been marked and have to journey through the world to kill the dragon. You're aided by a group known as the Pawn Legion, who are subservient half-humans with no real will of their own. Their only purpose is to find the Arisen and help them become a dragon slayer. There's more to this story, and you already might be thinking it doesn't really make sense. I'll get to it later. For now, I just want to set the stage so people can understand how the game works. You're traveling through the world, fighting monsters and solving problems, with the final battle with the dragon looming at the end. Aside from the genre standards, finding and accepting quests, exploring hostile areas on the map, the two biggest features the game has are its combat system and interacting with the Pawn Legion. Everyone makes their own pawn. This is like creating a second character after you make your own. You get to customize them just as much as you did to yourself, and you even get to name them. Every player has their own main pawn that is more or less always going to be with you while you travel. Pawns can gather knowledge about quests, monsters, and different combat techniques. You can have up to three pawns with you at any given time. The two that aren't your main pawn are drawn from the game's multiplayer component. You hire the main pawns of other players to be your support pawns. Other players can hire yours too, and occasionally when you rest at an inn, your pawn will inform you that some other player took them for a grand adventure and that they have acquired new knowledge. This all happens without any interruption to your game. Your pawn doesn't disappear when hired, a copy of them is created for the other player. Combat is arguably the most important part of Dragon's Dogma. It has several key features that are stronger together than they are individually. There's a standard leveling system, but also vocations that act like jobs from some Final Fantasy titles. You can level up with these and gain new abilities and augments, some of which can be used by other vocations. These are split into the usual trinity: fighter, rogue, and spellcaster. Some vocations are hybrids that mix things up between the three. Most enemies are made up of more than one thing. This is sort of hard to explain, but visual examples should help a lot. You can swing a sword and hit an enemy's arm, and it will damage the actual arm as well as an entire monster. You can choose a part of a creature to attack. This sounds a lot like chopping off tails in Dark Souls, but the concept is taken further than that. Many monsters in the game are far larger than you, so you have to attack their heads or wings or even small weak points like the eye of a cyclops. Drakes take a lot more damage when you attack their hearts. The game also uses a similar system found in Shadow of the Colossus. You can jump onto enemies and climb around on them. This is to use your small size as an advantage and to also better position yourself to strike at these weak points. So that's a brief summary of the game. Travel with your pawns, kill some monsters, complete some quests. Hunt for the dragon that stole your heart, level up both yourself and your main pawn, try out some different jobs, play with the game's unusual combat mechanics. This is usually the point in the video that I'll say, there are going to be spoilers from this point onward, games are best played with as little outside information as possible, blah 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 blah. This is still true, but for the first time since I started this channel, I think this game actually benefits from being played with some sort of reference guide. I ended up finding a lot more to enjoy on my second playthrough than my first, since I need to safely ignore a lot of the filler crap that Capcom padded around the game. To put it another way, the game's story isn't worth paying attention to. All of the quests are forgettable, so the only real reason to play is for the combat and pawn systems, which can't really be spoiled. Chances are you've already seen a lot of the monster types, and the game has to be played yourself to really enjoy them. There's also the myriad of problems the game has that makes it difficult to recommend, even though I kind of enjoyed my time with it, of which I can't really show without going into detail. I suggest watching for a few more minutes before deciding if you want to stop and play the game yourself. So why play games? What sort of experience are you hoping to have? What main quality do you look for that makes you like a game or makes you dislike it? The list I've come up with isn't exhaustive, but I think it covers the major categories. For fun, there's a game mechanic that you really enjoy. For challenge, you want a game that makes you learn and master something in order to conquer it. For art, whether it's visuals or sound, or whether you're an admirer or an artist yourself, you want to be immersed in that side of games. For story, you find games fun enough, but you're really into the medium for interactive stories, or standard linear narratives that you guide a character through. For progression, you like the feeling of gathering experience or knowledge, or even in-game resources. You like filling up bars and ticking off checkboxes. You like hunting for achievements and grinding. For competition, some sort of multiplayer, PvP. I'd like to do a video on just this topic sometime in the future, but for now I'm bringing it up because it relates to how jarring my first few hours with Dragon's Dogma were. Some games will ignore parts of this list. Some don't have stories. Some don't even have graphics. Others choose to focus intently on one or two things here. Some try to do all of them. I enjoy almost all kinds of games. I can find things to like in all of these categories. I don't like grinding, but I also can't ignore that I do like receiving steady increases in options. Some of my fondest memories of World of Warcraft were leveling my first character and looking ahead hungrily at the skill list, wondering if the next ability I'd get was going to be cool or not. But just because a game tries to do something doesn't mean it does it well. Some multiplayer modes in games are atrocious afterthoughts, or are dangerously undercooked. The same can be said for everything else on the list, which is why I'm always hesitant to dismiss an entire genre of games or a large part of one. Once again, even though I feel like I hate grinding, I still like Diablo 3. There are two issues I want to demonstrate with this list. That mixing certain combinations of these categories often results in disaster, and that the player needs to be shown clearly and quickly what kind of game that you're having them play. For the first problem here, look at how a progression system would ruin PvP multiplayer. The heart of any competition is fairness and balance, or else what's the point of it? If you're playing a shooter and your team has guns that deal less damage than the opposing team, then it's not really something that's worthy of your full attention. Yet that doesn't stop a lot of games from smashing these two together, with some having more extreme takes than others. Progression systems are, in my opinion, an epidemic in modern gaming, but they can still work well. I'm playing Stardew Valley right now and loving it, and that game is one big tangled mess of progression loops. But my fear is always that these steady drips of experience points and gain new skill levels and the like will stop being complementary parts of games, and instead that illusion of mastering a system will end up replacing it. It's very difficult to have a skill-based game that allows you, the player, to level up outside of the game, while also letting you, the character, level up inside of it. Dragon's Dogma is a progression game disguised as a skill-based one. It has two big instances of what I think is unintentional deception, the first being that the open-world map is a hell of a lot smaller than you'd think upon first seeing it, and that its deep, player-driven combat system is nothing of the sort, and is almost purely determined by stats, grinding, and gear than anything else. This appearance of a skill-based system is so strong that you'll often find people defending the game on discussion forums, fans that are insistent that the game's all about skill. To the point that some compare it to Dark Souls, I've even seen the same get good mantra said about the game. So already I think many who have played the game might disagree with what I just said, so let me go through it all while also explaining how my first few hours with the game went, and how I didn't fully grasp how reliant the game is on gear and grinding until I was deep into hard mode. Also, I just want to reiterate real quick that progression-based games aren't inherently bad, but it's a difficult mix to pull off with an action RPG, rather than just a plain old vanilla one. Combat encounters are split into two types, big bosses or hordes of fodder. Sometimes they mix and you'll have to clear some smaller enemies while a bigger one stomps about. Smaller enemies aren't really that interesting and tend to die quickly. It's the larger ones that make the game unique. You can't directly control your pawn. You can shout suggestions, but you'd have better luck teaching a baby calculus. The options on your own character are the primary way you'll be going through encounters, and you are also heavily limited here, but it depends on your vocation. In general, you'll always have light and heavy attacks and your jump. These cost zero stamina and can be spammed. Then you have special attacks which you select by holding down the triggers on your controller. So your face buttons will change from light and heavy attacks to special ones that you choose and assign from a list that you unlock while you gain vocation levels. Things like a rapid charge or a sidestep swipe, both skills and magic work in a similar way. This system is initially awkward since you have to learn how the buttons are modified by holding down the triggers, but I like it now that I'm used to it. It's similar to other games, there's always a learning period for controls, and in this case it pays off and feels natural by the end. The flow to battles goes like this then, spend your stamina on special attacks and then spam regular ones while your stamina refills, very slowly. Climbing also drains your stamina so you have to choose what to spend it on and when to go into spam mode to let it refill. This may all sound good. There are options, right? Variety too, with different skills that you can choose yourself. But if you're after a player skill-based, challenging system, then all of this is ketchup and mustard slathered on to hide a rotten burger. And here are the three reasons for that. Combat damage calculations, healing and resource management, wakestones. When I started writing my thoughts down, I was certain that the way damage is calculated is the true culprit for ruining combat in this game, but now that I'm further into it, I think that all three of these are equally responsible for bringing the game down, and all three would have to be fixed for the combat system to work. Let's go through them. There are only four stats in the game: strength, magic, defense, and magic defense. Enemies have them too, and in most games that I've played, these usually translate into percentage reductions. So the higher defense or armor that you have, the more damage is prevented. Let's make it really simple and go with 50 damage. So in a game that uses percentages, if you have a 50% damage reduction from stats, 50 damage will be split down to 25. Same for enemies. So as your weapon damage grows, you're still doing more damage, but it's being cut down by these percentage modifiers so it doesn't get completely out of control. In Dragon's Dogma, however, these are flat reductions, so if an enemy has 50 defense and you do 50 damage, he takes 0 damage, or maybe 1, it's not exactly clear if it ever hits actual 0. If you do 51 damage, the enemy will take 1, if you do 52, it takes 2, and so on and so forth. This method of calculating damage is insane for anything other than a game about grinding gear and stats, and even then it's still kind of crazy. There are walls of progress you can hit because of this, especially in the endgame where enemies have so much defense that you simply cannot kill them without investing literal hours of your life into whittling them down for 1 damage per hit. Here are some examples. These are two endgame bosses, a condemned cyclops and an elder ogre. These are both found in the Dark Arisen expansion area of the game. When I first arrived here, my character's gear was subpar, and as you can see, I am doing no damage to them. Even when I painstakingly climbed to the cyclops' major weak spot, I am still doing very little damage for every strike. I'm doing these fights with the best possible weapon I could have at this point. You get an endgame weapon for beating the base version of the game that I hadn't done yet because I wasn't sure if it would affect the expansion. Things change after you beat the last boss, after you kill the dragon. None of the other enemies in this area have this extreme defense rating, so it's doubly bad since it's both an unexpected spike and an obstacle that you cannot surpass with any amount of skill, just insane amounts of patience. After I went and killed the last boss for that weapon, you can see immediately what the difference was. Here's what the fights look like now. Look at how fast the HP is dropping down, because gear and stats are so important. Looking at it a different way, the system is so fundamentally broken. Think of the numbers. Let's say an enemy has 100 defense, you have 101 attack rating. So you're dealing 1 damage, and when you level up once and gain, say, 1 more attack rating, you're now doing 2 damage. Which means for one level, you have now doubled the amount of damage you're dealing to this monster. Gain 8 more measly damage points, and now you're dealing 10 times the damage. Next up is healing, and it's here that Dragon's Dogma feels like Dark Souls and Skyrim had a baby, and the poor bastard inherited all of the worst qualities of both of its parents with some unique twist of its own. Dragon's Dogma is the game that made me realize that how you handle punishing mistakes and recovering from them might just be the most crucial thing for an action game to nail down. If you don't get this right, then nothing else can be built on that broken foundation. Think about your favorite action game and how you could shatter how it works with just little tweaks to its healing system. In Dragon's Dogma, here's how you heal yourself after you take damage. You pause the game, you open your inventory, you go over to your healing grass, you consume as much as you like, you unpause the game, you're now instantly back to full HP with no animation or any lag time for the healing taking effect. You can farm as many of these items as you like, they don't weigh much, in the main city you can buy unlimited quantities of them from a shop, they're not even expensive. You can pause and do this while you're stunned, asleep, held in a monster's grasp, climbing on their back, doing your taxes, in the middle of an attack, any time. There's no limitation on when you can heal like this. I have more to say about this, but first, let's go to the last one on the list of three real quick, because incredibly, it gets even worse than this, because death itself can be circumvented in the exact same way. Wakestone shards can be found throughout the world. If you collect enough of them, they can turn into a full wakestone. They're rare, so rare that I didn't even know this mechanic existed or had a chance to use one until I was in the last part of the game. A dungeon opens up toward the end where you can farm whole wakestones, not just shards. They're everywhere in this dungeon. There's even a quest to collect 20 of them, and these are literally extra lives. This dungeon is like a more complicated version of the top secret area for farming 1-ups in Super Mario World. You can carry dozens of these things, and whenever you forget to eat your healing grass or whatever, you can use Awake Stone when you die and come instantly back to life on the spot. No resetting the fight, the boss is still damaged. You can farm these and then use as many as you'd like to get through fights. So yeah, even if you fix how damage is calculated, this still isn't a game based on player skill. You might be wondering how the game can be challenging at all if this is the case, and it's a good question. In normal mode, it doesn't. There's no challenge to be found here. In hard mode, damage spikes so hard that you're pretty much killed in one hit from everything in the game. It's the only way to make it work, right? Since if you can pause and full heal at any time, then you need to prevent that option. But even this doesn't work, because it's something the game makes you grind through. The way damage works also applies to you, so you grind through levels and gear, and you will hit this hilarious moment around level 50 or so when your defense reaches a threshold where you go from dying in one hit to taking virtually zero damage in the space of a few upgrades and levels. In fact, because hard mode drastically increases the amount of experience and gold you get from kills in addition to their damage, I actually found it easier to go through after I grinded up enough levels. There's a larger time investment for your first dozen hours, but after that you gain levels faster and keep steady with the monsters you'll encounter throughout the game. So basically the game is, if you can't do damage, you need more levels and gear. If you're getting killed in one hit, you need to go somewhere else and grind levels and gear. If you want to push through anyway, farm up Wake Stone so you can justify taking risks to deal more damage in what can be hour-long battles if you're fighting something before the game wants you to. Let's stop here and look at the game in a different way, similar to what I did in my Darkest Dungeon video. So let's pretend that I'm an idiot. Maybe some of you won't have to pretend. Let's say that it's obvious that the game is all about grinding and that I missed it somewhere, that I'm wrong to judge it harshly for being like this, and should evaluate it for what it actually is instead of what it could have been. So we remove all challenge from the combat system. We look at how you can make it fun for yourself instead. So you try out different vocations and enjoy focusing attacks on enemy weak points and trying to do it in creative, flashy ways. The game is okay like this, but I don't find it very rewarding, especially considering there's so much downtime between encounters. I mentioned that the world map is smaller than you'd think. Seen here, when you first start out, you only have a tiny portion visible and this giant void of space around you to fill in. You take a few steps and you've barely moved along it. This game must be massive, but unlike something like Skyrim, which has this huge open map, Dragon's Dogma is instead a handful of smaller areas connected by narrow routes. If you look at the full map, you can trim away a lot of extra parts that you can never explore, and the end result is something that's surprisingly small. It's also very sparsely populated. You'll spend most of your time fighting fodder groups of bandits, undead, goblins, and saurians. There are several points on the map that have bigger monsters like Cyclops and Chimera, but they're spaced far from each other. It should also be said that enemies respawn in the same location with the same formation, so you'll be repeating the same content over and over when you grind, not even new stuff. There are also very few big monsters that you can find at this stage of the game. There's the Cyclops, the Armored Cyclops, the Ogre, and the Magic Golem, all of which use the same base model that's altered. Then you have the Chimera, a Drake, an Undead Lich, and that's about it really. There are other big monsters, but they're saved for the endgame and aren't found on the map. Apparently the Griffin can attack in the open world, but I never saw this happen, only when it was tied to a quest. So we have a lack of variety in the big monsters, an uninteresting open world that has you running around doing nothing more than you'll be fighting. It's a grinding game that makes it difficult for you to actually grind. One of the best strategies I read online for getting gear was to save and reload your game at chests to open them until you get a rare drop, as an example of how ridiculous it can get. As for quests, you have notice board ones that are usually just kill X amount of monsters that auto-completes when you're done. There are also frustrating escort quests that I avoided at all times. Then there are side quests with stories that occasionally link back to the main story, but without fail they fall into two types. Go somewhere in the world, kill some monsters, run around town and talk to people. That's it. Going to these areas was very frustrating on my first playthrough, since I went around exploring the whole world instead of going through the main quest, so the handful of dungeons and towers and caves that I found had sections blocked off, locked doors usually, that don't open up until you have the appropriate quest to go there, which is strange for an open world. There was no time that I found an interesting place that I could immediately go into and explore. All of them were gated. It's one of the reasons why I ended up enjoying my second character more than the first, because I knew to ignore these areas and not bother with them until I had the quest from later on. Speaking of learning what to avoid, some vocations are far more fun than others. This might come down to personal preference, but I found the fighter and warrior classes to be incredibly boring, and that's usually the archetype that I play in these games. You're so limited in what you can do. Meanwhile, the more agile classes can switch between melee swings and using the bow, get a double jump for more fun exploration, generally move about a lot faster, and most importantly, get a dodge roll, which adds so much to making combat enjoyable for yourself. Getting around the world is fairly easy later on with the port crystal system. I've seen other people complain about this, even for the PC release. I know that things were changed from the console one. You get an infinite use teleport stone that you can use with a limited amount of port crystals to make your own fast travel points. However, just like in Fallout 4, if you keep one port crystal on you at all times, you can teleport back and forth from town as much as you like, forever, since you can port back and pick up the crystal and continue on where you left off and then place it down in another place later on. So why does the game insist on so much inventory management? Look at all this crap. You have to deposit it all one stack at a time. It even makes you have to split the carry weight between your pawns instead of just having a communal inventory. If healing items were heavy, then I could see why this would be necessary, since you need to limit the amount that the player can carry for healing during combat. But they're purposefully light, so why even have the system in the game? There's so much unnecessary clutter you can pick up too. This was the second big reason that I preferred my hard mode playthrough, since I knew what I could ignore. In fact, I never felt any need to use the crafting system in the game, since I could buy all the healing grass I needed for next to nothing. Apart from gear upgrades, it was all a waste of time. Just like the lantern you have to carry and go into the clunky inventory to use at night, you have to carry around oil for it, and this is all fine, I guess. You don't have to carry around arrows for your bow, but it makes you need oil, so it's sort of weird. The bad part is that if the lantern gets wet, the light goes out, and the way you relight it is to open your inventory, put the lantern away, go back to the game and watch the animation, then go back to the inventory and pull out the lantern again, and watch the next animation, and the lantern is magically dried when it's put away, and then you can continue on. There's so many of these short but repeated time wastes in the game that slow everything down, like how you have to loot the same damn pile of stuff multiple times to get it all, instead of having it all looted in one shot. Why is that a thing? Yet the game has the foresight to give you infinite stamina and safe spaces so you can sprint around quickly to save time. It's weirdly inconsistent. There's only one major city in the game, Grand Sorin, which you arrive at shortly after leaving your starting town, which is also the only town in the entire game. It's another way the world feels empty. It's another way that the game world feels like a poor match for the gameplay. To sum it all up, the endgame and Dark Arisen expansion ended up being the best parts of my time with Dragon's Dogma. They were densely packed with monsters and loot, and allowed me to quickly move on to the next fight without needless travel time through a dead world. There's more monster variety now, since the game was holding some of its cards until this moment, and there's a better, more interesting way to acquire and upgrade gear. But it came so late in the game, and so long after dozens of hours of grinding, that I simply didn't care anymore. I was sick of it, and having to grind even more to beat this area, which I still did just to see it through, ended up being a chore. Dark Arisen is based on an island, and there are huge Colosseum rooms that spawn a random set of large monsters for you to fight each time you enter, so you can go in, fight, and then leave and immediately re-enter within seconds to fight a different set. It could be a group of Cyclops, or a Hydra, or a Drake, or almost anything really. And I think it speaks volumes that when I really earnestly reflect back on the time I spent with Dragon's Dogma, that entering and leaving and re-entering this room was my favorite part of the whole game. Before a final section on gameplay, let's look briefly at the story. Like almost everything in Dragon's Dogma, the narrative here is confusing in how it's trying to be multiple things at once. In general, I'm surprised that some fairly accomplished developers at Capcom worked on this game. Ones that did Resident Evil, Devil May Cry, and Breath of Fire, because it feels like a too ambitious attempt by a group of first-timers. What I'm trying to say is that almost everything in the game has a huge amount of potential, but it's bogged down by some really questionable choices. The story is no different. So we start out with a dragon attacking a town for seemingly no reason, and what kind of opening is that, right? Who would ever write a story that begins like that? Certainly not me. The game gave me a gift within the first 15 minutes. A pawn plops out of a rift and wordlessly pledges himself to you, and you sort of stare at him and say nothing. Then you awkwardly cut to another person who saw the exchange, who then comments on how you just spoke to the pawn and explains how people falling from the sky is normal here and just don't even question it. And the gift was that this was so underdeveloped and absurd that I was able to justify ignoring the story for the rest of my time with the game. I didn't have to care anymore. People are going to talk about things that didn't actually happen because cinematics don't match dialogue, half-human slaves are falling from the sky, and my character is the only one in the world who doesn't already know about it. Cool, I don't have to pay attention, let's just focus on gameplay. But of course I felt compelled to give it another chance on my second playthrough, and what I slowly began to understand surprised me, because the game is trying so desperately hard to tell a good story, but doesn't know how. In fact, it's so inconsistent that I wonder if it's been translated properly. Some scenes felt like some people sat in a room and just tried to put words to the cinematics with what sort of fit instead of actually translating the dialogue. Not to mention times when the subtitles didn't match what was being said. You have moments like this where you're following a guy through a city, and he approaches a house and the door automatically opens, then he pushes open empty air, and then he knocks that same empty air. There's a scene later on when you meet the Duke's new bride in her room because you are having a secret affair with her. Then the Duke shows up and you hide, and he starts to choke her to death on the bed. You can interrupt him to save her, and you're accused of attempting to rape the Duchess. You're sentenced to prison and tortured, like actually physically tortured. Then you break out of jail within seconds, and the game continues like this whole thing never happened. Your torturer is like, hey bro, what's up? You can't attack him out of revenge, you just get magically teleported back to prison. The Duke doesn't even care about what happened. He still talks to you, gives quests, proclaims you as the savior of the realm. He showers you with gold moments before you get the follow-up quest to go and steal his wife away from a fort that he's locked her in. It doesn't make any sense, and this is just the beginning. The entire narrative is a cycle. After you kill the dragon, you go through a credits scene, but it isn't real. The game doesn't make this very clear either. It isn't done yet, and you still have a chunk of content to get through before you've actually finished it. Fans of Dragon's Dogma call this the post-game, which I think is a terrible name for it. It should be post-dragon instead, since this isn't optional content. You're not finished yet. This isn't the first dragon that's attacked, and you are not the first arisen to be marked. The Duke himself is one such person who was chosen in the past. I'd estimate that it's once every 50 years or so. A dragon shows up, chooses an arisen, and they have to go through an adventure to stand against it. So you'd think that the world would learn to prepare for this pattern, but no, not really. You don't even do anything to fight the dragon until the end. Your quests, in order from the beginning, are fight a cyclops at an encampment near your home village, then fight a hydra at the same place, deliver the hydra's head to the duke, the previous arisen, go to some fort on the other side of the map, kill three more cyclops, journey into a flooded temple, kill another cyclops. The game has you killing so many of these that they became more like a cyclops. Such a bad joke. Infiltrate a cult in the catacombs, thankfully there's no cyclops here. Deliver a tablet to an even older arisen who lives in the hills to the north. Travel to another corner of the map and kill a griffin. Then, in the very next quest, travel to the exact same place to kill a wizard instead. It recycles the same content so soon, it's even the same boss arena at the top of the tower. Interfere with the trial of a local nobleman. Deal with an uprising at a fort to the north. Kill a cockatrice that attacks the city. Then journey to the last part of the game to kill the leader of the cult that worships the dragon, but not before killing a few more cyclops here. So let me ask you, does anything on the list sound like it has anything to do with the dragon? The big bad boss doesn't even do anything else for the whole game. Your town is the only one it seems to have attacked. You're doing busy work for the duke instead. Your character is a silent protagonist, which is a terrible choice since that's usually employed to make you feel like you are the character rather than controlling another person. But you're not given any choices or opportunities to react to many things, so it makes a lot of quest moments frustrating when you get into a bad spot and your character chooses to run away instead of stand and fight, or doesn't attempt to explain what's going on. It's all very strange. Side quests are no better, but most of these exist for a reason. The game has romance plots, multiple ones, not just the Duchess. These seem like a waste of time at first, but the more I played, the more I realized that almost every side quest nudges you into bonding with a character. Whether that's one of two traveling merchants, or a woman who lived in your village, or a knight in the Duke's army, or a witch in the woods, or the aforementioned Duchess, who I imagine is what most players will go with since it's the only questline that makes the romance part of it blindingly obvious from the get-go. The game is trying to set you up with a beloved through one of these many side quests, so that no matter what, you end up paired with someone by the end. And this is what I mean by potential in the story, since this is a deliberate, understated mechanic that ties into the main story without you realizing it until the end. Grigori finally does show up when you confront the cult leader. You end up at the same place that the tutorial was set in at the beginning of the game. You face the dragon and learn that he's captured your beloved, whoever that might end up being. You're given a choice like each arisen before you, to sacrifice your beloved to the dragon, or to try and kill him yourself. If you make the sacrifice, he'll fly away and let you lie to everyone that you were successful in killing him. If you stand against him, he promises that he'll kill you and your beloved anyway. I don't think this is a real choice. Most players came here for a boss fight. There's no real hesitation here. You want to fight the dragon. And if the rest of the story was told well, with some developed characters and a coherent plot, then this twist could be cool, since it's made clear that the past arisen in the world took the dragon's bargain. It's why the Duke goes mad and tries to choke his wife in that scene. It's one of the better ways to have a twist in a story, since it makes previously confusing details click into place. But because of that underdeveloped narrative, it sadly doesn't make sense, and it only gets worse as time goes on. I can already ruin it with one simple question, though. Why? Why does the dragon want your beloved? Why is that bargain an option? The way he speaks to you is downright friendly in some scenes. It seems like he wants you to kill him, which almost makes sense in the next reveal a little later on. You kill Grigori, you get your heart back, you go through the credits. Prior Arisens die now that the dragon is dead. The Duke, being the youngest of them all, rapidly ages instead of crumbling to dust. Part of Grand Sorin is destroyed and more dangerous monsters are unleashed upon the world. Why? Who knows? It's never clear why killing the big bad dragon would make the world a harsher place. The story finally gets interesting here. It's another reason why I paid attention on my second playthrough. The Duke accuses you of taking the dragon's bargain just like he did and banishes you, and you're forced to run away. The section of the city that was destroyed revealed a great opening to a dungeon. You fall through it and can land on different levels, which is sort of cool and allows you to quickly move between section to section and fight monsters with little downtime. You collect wake stones here to proceed through the story. You use them to ascend to another realm to fight God. You go through some interesting looking sequences and pass by all the supporting characters in the game. You fight God some more and it's revealed that he's an Arisen. He's the character you are playing as in the tutorial. He's one of the few Arisen who didn't take the dragon's bargain and acted just like you did. That there's a cycle to the dragon and the Arisen of killing them both and ascending to become the new god of the world. Your soul is used and spent in the process to foster constant growth, and this is a necessary cycle to have a fresh soul for God to use. If you fail this battle, you fall back to the planet and transform into the dragon. The opening cinematic repeats. You're the new Grigori. You mark a new Arisen. If you succeed, you kill God and take his place, and there's nothing you can do but run around invisible through some parts of the world. It's really awkward, actually. You have no choice but to kill yourself. You fall back to the planet and die, but the pawn you made takes your body and becomes human through you or something. I don't know. It's weird, right? It's trying so hard to be profound, but it doesn't make any sense. If there's this larger cycle going on, why does the dragon want a beloved from the Arisen? Is it some test to make sure their soul is good enough to challenge God? Then why unleash more monsters? When an Arisen becomes a dragon, do they retain free will? If so, why do they go along with it all? If not, how does that work? There's so many unanswered questions that ruin the whole thing for me, which I think aren't answered because there is no answer. Like the gameplay side of Dragon's Dogma, I feel like there might be something special hidden under all of this, and it's a real waste of potential. So that was the story, and like I said, it ties with gameplay to explain why I don't hate this game despite its shortcomings. It tried to be different, very different, and I have to respect that, even if it failed in something close to an entertaining blaze of glory. I've heard that the game might get a sequel based on the success of the PC port, and in response to that, I hope that Dragon's Dogma 2 has more focus on its key features. If they want a skill-based action game, then they need to trim away the reliance on consumable items. You can do the same thing with stamina as you can do with healing, just gobbling down food and potions to bump your endurance back to full at any moment. So many cool features in the game are ruined by this lack of focus. Climbing on giant monsters, one of the major draws the combat has, is a waste of time in many situations. You can get shaken off and have your stamina quickly drained, something that can be triggered randomly. There's no real gameplay to be done here. Either you lose all your stamina, or you don't. Which is a shame, because these moments where you can kick onto a monster, attack its head, and then jump away when it tries to grab you and attack again are thrilling. If the game had a combat system based on avoiding attacks and using stamina wisely, something closer to how you can ease and tighten your grip in Shadow of the Colossus, then you've just made this part of the combat so much better. For the rest, it's all about those resources. I don't think that regenerating health is the best way to go, but if the game is going to stay more about grinding, I think it'd be a far better fit than spamming potions mindlessly. You could have fights being about cycles of hit and run tactics, with you only being able to take 4 or 5 hits before dying, 2 or 3 for bigger, more dangerous enemies. Or you could have enemies spawn healing globes whenever you hit a threshold of damage. Maybe every half of their HP bars, so you can have that same cycle. You have to do X amount of damage without taking damage yourself before you have a chance to heal again and repeat. The open world needs more to do and more to see. More quests that aren't just kill-a-thons. More interesting, unique places. If not, cut it all and go for something more condensed like the expansion's Bitter Black Isle. But even here, improvement is needed, since the 2 endgame dungeons in this game reuse areas. And I don't mean backtracking. Well, I mean, there is backtracking, but even new areas use the exact same map all over again, just tweaked in certain ways. One hallway will be closed off this time, or an area will be flooded, but it's the same map you're going through 3 or even 4 times, just like some areas were reused in Dragon Age 2. Monster variety is sorely lacking. When Armored Cyclops showed up, I thought this was the beginning of armored variants, dragons with a plate protecting their heart. It could be a cool feature to have to choose abilities that can remove armor, magic to melt it or strike it away, or crawling on an enemy to cut straps to get rid of it. but the game still needs more of these big monsters. I think it's a shame that the Beholder fight is saved for the end, since it has this wonderful flow to its different phases, and incorporates carving off multiple limbs. That responsive damage system really works here. If the game was all about encounters like this, with skill-based systems rather than grinding ones, then I think it would be something really special. But the game needs a lot of attention to make it work. My guess is that's why it became all about stats, because it was too hard to sort it all out. Monsters awkwardly clip against each other and teleport around rooms, enemies will deal damage to you before their animations are finished or even hit you, sometimes you'll be teleported into a grab. Every class needed something like the Strider's roll and double jump. It's necessary to give more options during fights. Instead, it's all about filling up bars. XP, vocation levels, pawn knowledge, gear slots, gear ratings. I can see how it could become fun toward the end when the game becomes all about it, and for those interested in the game, I heavily recommend rushing to that end game as quickly as possible for that reason, but it'll always come back to personal preference. I wish the game focused on other things in its gameplay instead of what it does now, because without any tension or challenge, with HP sponge enemies that take forever to die, and opening up your inventory to heal whenever you take damage, combat in this game feels like a waste of my time. Thanks for watching. If you're new to the channel and this was the first video of mine that you've seen, thank you for taking a chance on something that's so long. Consider subscribing if you'd like to see more videos like this, or checking out my Patreon page if you'd like to support the work that goes into these. I try to release 3 videos every month. I'm playing Stardew Valley at the moment. I'm hoping to do a short video on it soon. After that, I'm not sure what I want to do. I want to play The Witness, but I also have some Dark Souls content that I'd like to get prepared for the end of the month. Dark Souls 3 is a big release for me in April, so I prefer to have a few videos prepared ahead of time while I'm playing it, but I don't know if that's feasible. My guess is that it's going to take me a while to fully complete. Either way, I'll try to keep people updated on Twitter and with Patreon posts. Thanks again, I'll see you next time.